Hi, my name is Ada. I'm not a professional musician, but I always loved electronic music. And in recent years, I've been learning how to produce it completely as a hobby. I've had the opportunity to explore a couple of music production tools. Some of them, like digital audio workstations, have so much potential and possibilities. But for me, they just don't give me as much fun making music as the MC-707 Groovebox. I know it has its limitations, but somehow it has remained my favorite musical instrument. And about the limitations. Some of the MC Groovebox's limitations are just too much even for me. Yes, I almost hear you saying the lack of sidechain compression, and I completely agree. By the way, I have a solution for that too, but I'll try to make a video about it later. Today, however, I'd like to address another problem with these machines. The lack of official support for the MIDI System-Exclusive messages communication. Other high-end Roland products like Phantom series have the system-exclusive messages protocol disclosed in their MIDI implementation charts. It allows users to control almost any configurable parameters via MIDI interface using, for example, an external hardware controller. And all that without even touching any on-screen menu. Can you imagine how awesome would that be in the MC Grooveboxes? But the best thing is, it's totally possible. I decided to investigate that topic, and I did it. I hacked the MC Grooveboxes SysEx interface using simple self-made hardware and a Python script. After some coding and tweaking, I managed to control the Zen-Core synth engine in both MC-101 and MC-707 Grooveboxes with their MIDI interface. In this video, I'd like to share with you how I did it and how you can do it too. I'll show you not only how to interact with the MC Grooveboxes using MIDI SysEx messages, but I'll also tell you more general information about the data exchange with Roland instruments. Of course, I'll show you my experimental hardware and software test setup. This information can be useful if you want to recreate what I did or to figure out how to read and control other parameters of the MC Grooveboxes. My not-so-beautiful proof-of-concept test software is free and open source, and the link is available in the description. And about that, some disclaimers. Please remember the two things. First, if you decide to tweak with the instrument, you do it at your own risk, so don't blame me if you screw up your gear. The second thing is, that this video shows just a proof of concept inspiration in case you'd like to conduct your own further experiments. And I hope that it will help you to make something awesome. But please remember, the video definitely does not show a complete solution. It's just up to your creativity what you do with the information you get here. You may safely skip to the next section if you already know why you may want to control MC-101 or MC-707 over MIDI. But if you ask, why would I want to control the MC Zen-Core synth engine with an external hardware or software, then here are some ideas. One of the basic reasons is the possibility to implement some degree of hands-on control over the synthesis engine. If you have MC-101 or MC-707, you need to do something called menu diving to modify parameters of sound generators inside these instruments. For the MC-101, the situation is even worse because it uses C1 to C4 knobs for editing the Zen-Core parameters, and modifying some of the parameters requires something like a micrometer precision to set the desired values. Another example. Modifying envelope shapes by setting just a couple of numbers on screen without a proper graphical user interface can be quite a pain too. In general, if you tried it, you probably have this feeling that sound design on MC is at least inconvenient. Up to the point that sometimes it's just easier to record a sample from another synthesizer. Or sometimes to record a sample from a VST. In contrast, the possibility to control sound parameters at a deeper level in a more hands-on way creates a huge space for creativity in sound design and performance. So let's dive into it. Here I try to cover some necessary basic information, but in general I assume you have a basic understanding of MIDI communication, the hexadecimal number system, and you know a bit about computer programming. To develop the test software, I use Python because it's a very popular language. The key to control the ZEN-Core synth engine was to figure out two things. First, how to communicate with the MC grooveboxes. Fortunately, the communication method turned out to be the same as for many other Roland instruments. Second thing, which numbers, or we can say addresses, are assigned to specific sound parameters and how the synth patches are organized in the instrument. Further in this video, I'll tell you more about both of these things, but let's start with what's going on with the addresses and the patch organization. In electronic musical instruments manufactured by Roland, every single parameter which you can read or modify using system-exclusive messages has its own unique address. This way, we can unambiguously refer to each parameter. Thanks to the address, the instrument knows what we would like to read or modify. The range of addresses is limited, and not every address has its own assigned value. Some of the addresses may be empty. Some of them contain data which may not be interesting for us in this particular context of sound design, but can be interesting for some other things. And finally, some of the addresses contain information about the ZEN-Core synth patches. Such a concept of assignment of values or parameters to addresses creates something like an address space or a memory map known from microprocessor systems. In other Roland's musical instruments documentation, I noticed that their address spaces are specific to the particular instrument, but luckily for us, they have many common features also with the MC grooveboxes. The ZEN-Core sound parameters or the ZEN-Core patches are stored in specific data structures across the instrument's parameters memory map. It's not an official name, but in this video I will refer to them as ZEN-Core tone descriptors or ZEN-Core sound descriptors. In MC-101 and MC-707, the huge block of the ZEN-Core tone descriptors start at the address of 3 and 7 zeros hexadecimal. In other Roland musical instruments, the addresses and the organization of the ZEN-Core sound descriptors are different. In this diagram, you can see the starting addresses of the descriptor blocks in MC-707. As you can see, each track has 17 descriptors. Roland MC-101 and MC-707 really have a lot of ZEN-Core descriptors for tone tracks, because each tone clip and each tone track has its own descriptor. This results in 128 descriptors for just the clip sounds, plus one separate descriptor for each track tone. An interesting compatibility thing is that MC-101 has the same descriptor set as MC-707, but in 101 you can play sound only from the descriptors for tracks number 1 to 4. If you initialize a track as the tone track, only one of the 17 descriptors will be loaded to the ZEN-Core sound synthesizer of that track. If you choose track as the sound source, the track tone descriptor will be loaded to the track sound synthesizer. And if you choose clip as the sound source, one of the clip sound descriptors will be loaded at a given time. The other descriptors will be ready to be loaded immediately after you select another clip. You can see that I couldn't read the ZEN-Core sound patch for clip number 16 of track number 2. Both MC-101 and MC-707 didn't respond when I requested data from this particular clip. If you have any experience with it, please let me know in the comments. After I read the available documentation and I did some tests, it looks like we can interact with the ZEN-Core synth patches in MC grooveboxes the same way as we would interact with the patches in other Roland instruments with ZEN-Core synth engine. I didn't try to modify all the parameters of the ZEN-Core synth patches, but it's highly probable that they act the same way or in a very similar way to other Roland ZEN-Core instruments. So here's the important thing. As a starting point for your own further experiments, you can use MIDI implementation charts for other Roland instruments which use the ZEN-Core synth engine but disclose the system-exclusive message communication. Just remember that the base addresses of the ZEN-Core sound descriptors are different for different Roland products. So now we know what are the base addresses of the ZEN-Core sound descriptors in MC-707 and MC-101. Now let's see how to read and modify them. We can imagine a MIDI system-exclusive message as an empty box. A box that doesn't contain any useful information, but we can put some data in it. Gear manufacturers decide what to put in that box, or in other words, what data to put there and how the data should be ordered, or we can say structured. Two of the commonly used types of packets that we can put inside the SysEx messages for Roland instruments are data request one and data sect one, or DT1. Data request one allows us to read the internal parameters of the Roland instrument. And if you want to write the internal parameter to the Roland instrument, you may want to use the data set message or DT1. The DT1 message is also the response message to the data request message. Fortunately, Roland MC-101 and MC-707 use these messages too, and you can find information about them in Roland's MIDI implementation charts of a few other instruments. This diagram shows the system-exclusive message for requesting data from a Roland instrument that supports the SysEx communication. It is basically a SysEx message, but with a specific data structure inside it. We need to provide the model identification number in the message in bytes 3 to 6. It's just a series of numbers, 3 0 bytes and 5D or 5E hexadecimal, whether we communicate with MC-707 or MC-101. The field that distinguishes the data request message is at the index 7 and its value is 11 hexadecimal. The address will tell the instrument from which internal location you would like to read the data. The length field tells the instrument how many bytes of data you'd like to read. Please remember that the length field is very poorly supported in my software. It doesn't allow you to encode any values larger than 127, but I just don't think there is a need to implement such large reads, so I just left it this way. The instrument will return the data starting from the given address and will continue reading towards the higher addresses. The maximum number of returned bytes will be up to length, but if there is an empty location before the end of the requested length is reached, the MC-707 or MC-101 will just return less data. As a response, you will get the data set or DT1 message. You can also use the DT1 message to set the internal parameters of the Roland instrument. DT message structure is shown here on the screen. Here, the byte that allows the instrument to distinguish the message is 12 hexadecimal at index 7. And again, you specify the address to write the data, but this time you specify explicitly the data that you want to write. Each next byte of data fields will be written at the next higher address. Both the request and the dataset packets use a checksum byte. This byte contains a number which depends on the values of bytes from index 8 onward up to the checksum. For example, we take data from bytes of index 8 to 15 for the request message. The Python code that I used in my experimental script to compute the checksum is shown here. Checksum computing is also described in the MIDI implementation charts of the Roland instruments that support the MIDI SysEx communication. I conducted some experiments to show you the real contents of the SysEx packets that are transmitted over MIDI. In these experiments, I'm reading and writing two values, the coarse tune and the partial wave number for the left channel. I used a simple hardware setup with a USB to serial adapter and a serial port to MIDI converter. Of course, you can use other interfaces too. I think it should work with USB MIDI as well, but in that case, just remember to use different software libraries for interfacing the musical instrument. I wrote a Python script that sends and receives raw data over serial port using the PySerial library. This way, we can observe and have control over every single byte being transmitted. I use the script to scan the values from the instrument's address space to figure out where the ZEN-Core sound descriptors start. The script displays a lot of information on the terminal, so we can easily follow on the screen what's going on. As the first experiment, let's modify the ZEN-Core sound for track number 2. Let's make sure that the sound source is set to track. In my test project, it contains an internal wave-based sound. As you can see in here, the script also allows you to play a single test note via MIDI. Now, let's modify the coarse tune parameter, which is a part of the tone common substructure. The coarse tune parameter is available at the offset of 18 hexadecimal from the start of the tone common substructure. The modification is done here in this function. It reads the current coarse tune value, modifies it, and writes it back. The modification requires writing only one byte of data. I enter the sound menu with Shift plus sound and I navigate to coarse tune so that we can see what's going on. In the second experiment, also in track number 2 tone, let's modify the tone's left channel waveform of partial number 2. This requires us to compute the offset of the tone partial number 2 substructure and the offset of wave number left field in that structure. This time, the read and written value will be split into 4 bytes, but just 4 bits of each byte will be used. Again, I navigate in the sound menu to partial number 2 edit. Then I navigate to the subtab PCM. And you can see that the waveform changes with each message. Yes, I'm aware that the script isn't the fastest one and the code quality is far from beautiful, but I made it just as a proof of concept. And my further goal is to develop a hardware controller for modifying ZEN-Core synth parameters for MC-101 or MC-707. And a little bonus, how I figure out where to look for the ZEN-Core patches. The function for performing the memory scan and dump divides the address bits into 2 halves and scans only tiny chunks of the instrument's address space. This way, it works much faster so that you don't have to read every single byte from the instrument's address space. It also helped me that the ZEN-Core sound descriptors are aligned, and it's like that for all the Roland ZEN-Core instruments for which I compared the documentation. This way, it was enough to scan for a couple of bytes every 64 kilo locations. Such a scanning method and jumping between locations proved to be very efficient. I also noticed that the sound descriptors start with the ASCII strings. They are super easy to find even by looking at the memory dump in a CSV file. That's why I added the code that tries to display the contents of the address space as ASCII characters. Then I populated the entire matrix of available track tones and clip tones, mostly with some basic init tones. But I named the tones in such a way that I could tell which sound belongs to which address in the internal address space. I think this helped me the most. And that's why I didn't have to scan the entire address space, but I could scan just the beginnings of the areas suspected for containing the clip sound descriptors. Thank you if you survived watching this video until the end. I hope the information here will be inspiring for you to make something awesome. But if you find any information inaccurate, unclear, or you noticed errors, please let me know in the comments and I'll try to address it. It would be nice if you leave a like or a comment if you find this video useful or interesting in any way. Thank you again and see you maybe in the next video. Bye!